So last night we sent out the URL for the project page for project number two. So the index skeleton files we give you for the skip list, they're all ready to go. I was looking at the test case last night with Dana as well, and like the test suite we give you is not really obvious. It's a lot of stuff. So I'm going to try to clean it up over the next 2 days, and then we'll send an email out how to do a rebase to pull down, or fetch and rebase to pull down our latest changes. It just make it easier for you to like reason about what your index is actually doing, rather than just, you know, spits out some answer to say whether it's correct or not. But the one thing we're not going to provide you with are integrity tests to actually check the internal structure of your skip list. So because there's no standard API that we can provide you, because if we provide you the API, that sort of basically explains how you should do it. So this is something you're going to have to write on your own, right? To make sure you don't have dangling pointers, make sure you don't things are ordered correctly. Right, we'll have high-level tests to say, like, if I assert this thing, can I get it back? Or I do a scan, and do I get things in the right order? But we're not going to check the inside. Right, we're only going to check at the index API level. So I encourage you to write those things yourself. All right, so today we're going to talk about index locking and latching. And so the last, you know, three classes have been about concurrency control, and this is dealing with how to protect the data inside your database at sort of a logical level, like a tuple level, from concurrent transactions. And the idea is that we want to provide the serializable guarantees of our database system, or asset guarantees, and the concurrency control scheme is going to let us do that. So now for today and the next two classes, now we're actually going to be going at a sort of lower level and saying, how do you actually protect the index data structures? So before, with the concurrency control, we sort of ignored the idea that you have indexes, but in reality, there are indexes. And these means that we have another point of contention, another thing that could become incorrect if we have concurrent operations. So we're going to see how we deal with that. All right, so for today, we're going to discuss the difference between locks and latches in the context of indexes. Then I'll discuss the different ways you implement a latch, how to do latch crabbing, so how do you traverse a tree. And then we'll finish up talking about doing logical index locking. And logical index locking you need to do to prevent phantoms. But as you saw in the silo paper or the hackathon work, they weren't actually doing index locking. They were doing sort of extra work at the end, the validation phase. So this is sort of a technique of if you want to do this as you run to check, make sure that you're not getting phantoms, index locking is the way to do that. All right, so I don't think at this point we really need to define what an index is inside of a database, but everyone should know what it is. The main thing I'll say about it is indexes allow us to speed up accessing data, specific items of data that we need. But there's this trade-off between, yes, we have an index to make our lookups go faster, but we're paying at the cost of having higher overhead when we update the database, and higher overhead in terms of storing the indexes. Right? So if you have every single index you could possibly have in your database, it's going to run really slow when you update it, because you have to go through and update every single index. We talked about this last time when we talked about having to update the physical address and secondary indexes. Even though you may not actually update the values of those indexes, you still have to go update the where they're pointing to. And then storage space, obviously, if you're building an index on every single column, that's going to take up memory, and you're eventually going to run out of space to put data in. So the main thing the indexes are going to provide for us is that we'll be able to quickly locate data without searching through every single row. The metaphor that I always like to use for an index, it's basically the glossary in a textbook. If I want to look up the chapter on trapping, I would look up in the glossary, and it would tell me what page or pages I should go look at that has that term. So index is basically the same thing. So we'll see examples later in the semester about certain database systems where they don't allow you to have any indexes at all. So Vertica does something like this. And the idea there is, like, there's two ways to go about this. You just sort of pre-sort everything in the case of Vertica, and that's sort of the same thing as having an index, because you know have a structured way to find the data you're looking for. Or there's other techniques, like you have basically this cursor that is just iterating through the entire table over and over again, reading from beginning to end, doing a quick scan. And then if you want to access something, you just show up and jump on the cursor and scan along till you find the data you're looking for and sort of jump off. So like a train going around in a loop. So in that case, you don't need indexes, because you're just going to jump on the cursor and go where it goes. But for our purposes here for OLTP, you always want to index because you're usually doing point lookups, right, to find a small number of records. So that's the context that we're talking about this class and the next two classes, how to do this for OLTP applications. So there's basically two types of index data structures you can have. And again, this is sort of a refresher from the introduction course. Right, you have the order preserving indexes, things like the B plus tree, the skip list, the BW tree. And these are going to be like a tree-like structure that's going to allow us, that's going to maintain the keys in some sort of order, and that's going to allow us to do any possible type of query predicate or evaluation we want on it. Right, we can do the range scans, we can do the point lookups, and depending on how the data structure is implemented, we can go in both directions, both ascending and descending. And so I think last class I said it was n log n, it was a mistake, it's log n searches to traverse the tree and to find the things that you're looking for. And that's excluding if you have to scan the leaf nodes. And then the other type of indexes you can have are hash indexes. And again, this is just like a hash table you expect in Java or C. And this is an associative array that's gonna map the hash of a key to one particular record in the database. And for this, the nice thing about hash indexes is that they provide O1 lookups because it's a single hash, and you jump to the place you need that's going to have the data you're looking for. You may have to look at multiple entries if there's collisions or chains, but in general, you're not having to traverse the tree. The cost of doing this lookup is not as dependent on the size of your key space as it is with the order preserving index or tree index, right? So what's the obviously downside of the hash indexes? What's the one type of query you can't do on them? Range query, exactly, right? Because there's no way to, because the keys are not going to be actually stored, it's just the hash of the keys to tell you where to go. So for the next three classes, we're going to be assuming we're going to be dealing with order preserving indexes, because there's some interesting properties or interesting things we have to deal with in terms of locking and latching when we have these types of indexes. We'll talk more about the hash indexes later on when we talk about joins and other things. So what I'll say too is if you create a new database in MySQL or whatever your favorite database system is, and you call create index, chances are you're always going to get an order preserving index. Now, whether it's a B plus tree or something else, it doesn't matter, but it's always going to be one of these. Right? And the reason is because if you call, say, create index on your brand new database you spend a lot of money on, and it gives you a hash index, and the first query you write is select count star over some date range, it's going to be super slow because it's going to have to do a sequential scan, the hash index doesn't help you at all. And that's usually not something people would expect. So that's why there's always the database system will give you one of these. And it's not to say that the database system is not going to use hash indexes, and as we see as we go along, they're used all the time internally. Because it's not always exposed to you as the application developer. So it's a quick sort of background also too for these order preserving indexes. So the venerable the venerable B tree came out in 1972, and this is sort of the first the first definition or explanation of these sort of self-balancing trees. And so in the original version of the B-tree from 1972, they would store the keys and the values across all the different nodes of the tree. Right, so sometimes people in databases, they use the term B-tree and B-plus-tree interchangeably, and I'm guilty of this, but there is a concrete difference between the two. So again, the B tree stores the nodes, sort of the values and the keys and the values all throughout the tree. And in the context of a main memory database, the values are always going to be 64-bit pointers to the tuple that we're pointing at. And so this is more memory efficient than a B plus tree because each key is only going to appear once in the tree structure. Right? Now contrast this with a B plus tree, where they're only going to store the values in the leaf nodes. And the inner nodes, the non-leaf nodes inside of the tree, they're going to be essentially as acting as guideposts that allow you to traverse the tree and find the leaf nodes that have the keys or the values that you're looking for, the keys and values you're looking for. So the reason why everyone uses B plus trees, as we see as we go along, is that it turns out it's easier to manage, have concurrent access to a B plus tree than it is to a B tree. Because in this case here, you know that the only modification you're going to make to insert or delete a new record or key value pair in the index is only going to be done at the leaf nodes. And so therefore, as we talk about Krabby, you can see you can release locks or latches as you go down because you're not worried that someone else is going to change the internal structure of the tree above you because they're not allowed to do that without getting to the bottom first. So you're sort of having all the locks and latches you acquire always in the same direction going down. right? So think about this, if you had to do this in a B tree, you know, say I was doing, like I was inserting a new record, and I was in an inner level tree, and then I have to take latches on that, and then someone below me inserts something too, it's on the same path as me, and then we're both trying to do splits or merges at the same time, that would be really difficult to manage, because you have to sort of handle deadlock and deadlocks and other things like that. So in practice, the B plus tree is always going to be the better choice, and this is what everyone implements. Now we'll see on Tuesday next week, there were some database indexes that came out of the 1980s that were thought to be main memory optimized, these things called T-trees. And they were used for maybe about a decade, but everyone gave up on them because it turns out not only B plus tree is really good for disk systems, they're also really good for in-memory systems as well. So again, even though for the most part, almost every single in-memory system, every in-memory database system is going to implement a B plus tree, even though they're in-memory and it was designed from the 70s when it was meant for disk. So far in everything we talked about, we've talked about how to lock objects in the database. So we talked about two-phase locking, we talked about how to acquire locks on tuples or pages or tables or whatever, right? But the tricky thing now when we bring in indexes is that we can actually treat them differently than the sort of logical objects in our database, right? The tuples and tables, right? And the key thing is that we're going to allow other threads to make modifications to the index to change its actual physical structure. And that's okay, and that still would be correct, as long as the logical contents of the index are still consistent. So what I mean is that if I do start doing splits and merges all through my index, as long as I can still see the thing that I expect to be there, I'm okay with that, even though the structure has completely changed. So a really simple example here, say I have a height of one with one node B plus tree, right? And so we have this node A, and it has values 20 and 22, and we only have two keys in our index. So the first transaction comes along and wants to read key 22, well, it just does a binary search in this thing and it finds what it's looking for. But now, let's have another transaction at the same time, while transaction one is still active. So transaction one has gone and read 22 and popped out. Now transaction two comes along and it wants to insert 21. Well, it wants to put it between 20 and 22, but I only have support two keys in here, so I have to do a split, and I'll move 21, 22 over here, and then modify the route to now have 21 as the guidepost here. All right? So now when I come back with transaction three, it should be transaction one, but transaction one comes back and wants to read 22 again, it doesn't care that now it's 22 is over here on this different node. Right? It only cares that the logical contents of the index are consistent to what it was last time. I saw 22 before and I see 22 again. I don't care where it's actually stored. All right, so this is different than sort of the two-phase locking and stuff we saw in for our tuples, because this is now actually the internal how things are actually stored. All right? So the survey paper I had you guys read I actually like it a lot. Because it really lays out, like, here's everything you possibly need to know about index locking and latching. And it's sort of well written and you kind of understand it, it's a pretty easy read in my opinion. So in this work, he defines, he makes a distinction between the locks and latches. And we have to do this because in the context of databases, right, locks don't mean the same thing in like operating systems and other fields as it means in databases. We covered this before. In our world, a latch is equivalent to like a lock that people would just use in the context of like an OS or other system. So for indexes, the locks are going to be used to protect the logical contents of the index from other transactions, and you have to hold them throughout the entire duration of the transaction itself. And we need to be able to roll back any changes that we make to the index in case this transaction ever aborts. Now contrast this again with the latch, but that's going to be a low-level protection mechanism or protection primitive that's going to we're going to use for the critical sections, the critical regions of the internals of the index. And we're doing this to protect the index from other threads. And this is important to distinguish between other threads and other transactions because a transaction could be executed across multiple threads. Right? If you submit a batch of two queries exactly the same, for the same transaction, the database system can decide thread one is going to execute the first query, thread two is going to execute the second query. So then now they could be going at the same index. So we're protecting, the latches are going to protect the data structure from having concurrent access from different threads, even though it's still in the same higher level transaction. And so for this, we're going to hold the latches for the duration of the operation that we're doing. And the duration is sort of the same, you can think of this as sort of the API you guys are implementing for the project, right? Insert a record, read a record, right? That's considered one operation. So you need to hold all your latches while you're going in and doing that one thing. And then when you pop out, you release everything. And then for this, we don't need to worry about rolling back any changes because we don't care or we don't know anything about the transaction, right? We just know that there's some operations that are going on inside of our index, and whether that's in the context of a transaction or not, it's left to the higher level parts of the system, right? It's essentially left to the concurrency control component in the system. So he has this other table that I really, really like that lays out, again, the distinction between the locks and latches, and but describes in the how it's sort of they vary in all these different parts of how you would use them. Right? So you would say for an index lock, it's going to allow us to separate user transactions, and it's going to protect the contents of the database, and we're going to have to hold them throughout the entire duration of a transaction. And we're going to have different modes. We have shared, exclusive, update, and intention locks. And then if there's a deadlock, we're going to rely on the concurrency control component of the database system to have a way to detect that there's a deadlock and possibly resolve it. Right? This is the deadlock prevention, deadlock detection stuff we talked about before with two-phase locking. And then the way we're going to do this is either waits for or timeouts or aborts, like the wound and wait and die. That's all these things here. And the information we're going to keep about this is going to be held in the lock manager and not the index itself. And then contrast this with the latches. Again, we're using that to protect our threads for the in-memory internal data structures for the critical sections. And then we're going to only have two modes of locks. We're going to have reads and writes. And throughout this lecture, I'll try to distinguish a latch and a lock by saying there's reads and write latches and, you know, shared and exclusive locks. But they're essentially the same thing, right? A read lock is compatible with other read locks. And a write lock has exclusive access to whatever the data item it is. And the key thing, though, about how we're going to avoid deadlocks is through avoidance and coding discipline. So what I mean by that is you as like the database developer, the software engineer working on this index, it's up to you to be smart and clever and mindful that you write your code in such a way to avoid deadlocks when different threads try to acquire latches. So that means that you can't rely on some other higher level mechanism, like a background deadlock detection thread, to come in and rescue you. You have to be careful about how you order the different threads for acquiring latches in your data structure so that you don't have two guys trying to acquire the you know different things that the other guy holds. And again, this is going to be kept in a protected data structure. This is going to be essentially where to store the latch information inside of the sort of the index itself or the different data structure components, whereas the index locks have to be kept in somewhere else, and we'll see why as we go along. So another great thing that Abra also brings up too is this sort of commentary about what does it mean to have a lock-free index. And again, this is something where the language about this area is imprecise. So there's no sort of one canonical definition we can point at to say this is what it means to have a lock-free index. So the two possible choices you could have are, he means that either a lock-free index does not have any locks, as we defined in the last slide. And so this means that transactions are not going to acquire locks to access or modify the database through the index. But then we're still going to have to maintain some kind of low-level latches to allow us to install updates in the index. With no latches, it means that we can use like shadow paging or copy on write techniques, sort of like multi-versioning, to allow us to save pointers using an atomic compare and swap to install changes without having to acquire latches to do those things, right? But it's still, at the end of the day, you're still going to have to use some kind of locks in order to validate transactions if you care about running with a serializable isolation level. So the main thing he would, you know, to get out of this, he's basically saying there's no free lunch. That either you can have an index that doesn't use any locks, but you still need latches to protect it, or you can have an index that doesn't have any latches, but when you actually try to go validate the transaction to make sure things are correct, you're going to need to acquire locks. So again, when someone says they have a lock-free index, it takes a while to understand, you know, what that actually means. And so for our purposes, the skip list you guys are building is essentially the second one here. Right, there's no latches. The beta tree will be latch-free, and I think the art index that we'll cover as well will be latch-free. So before we now can talk about how you can use latches inside of an index, we need to talk about how do you actually build a latch, or how do you create one? So we're going to go through the four different main types there are. There may be other latch implementations that go beyond this list, but I would say these four are definitely the main ones that are used most often. There might be more other exotic ones that I don't know about, but for the most part, everyone implements one of these. So as a quick reminder from what we talked about last class, remember I defined this idea of a compare and swap operation. Remember that I said that was a single instruction that the CPU provides for you that allows you to examine the contents of some location in memory, check to see whether it has the value you expect to have, and if so, then you're allowed to install your new value. Right? So in this case here, I'm checking the memory location M to see whether it has the value 20, and it does. So in this case here, I can flip it and make it 30. And I said, remember, that this is provided to you by the compiler as an intrinsic or a built-in, where it looks like a function call, just like libc or something, but in actuality, the compilers can replace this with a single assembly instruction to perform this operation. And this is way faster than having to write the C code or the assembly yourself to do if clause and then the store for the value to write in this memory location. Now, I'm pretty sure every modern CPU supports compare and swap. Like I know ARM does, Power, and obviously x86. But if you're running on some kind of CPU that doesn't have this, then what the compiler will do is essentially recognize that you can't do the single instruction for this, and just replace it with the actual assembly to do it by hand. And then they'll install their own mutex or whatever you need to sort of protect this, make sure that it's still atomic. Again, for compare and swap, I don't think it's that big of an issue. When we talk more about SIMD, you'll see there's certain cases where if you don't have sort of the more modern SIMD instructions, the compiler just replaces them with the assembly code to emulate it. And you don't see the same performance benefit you get if you have the single instructions. Okay, again, so this is the low-level primitive that's going to allow us to do it's going to allow us to implement all the latches that I'm going to talk about now. So, the first way to implement a latch is to use an operating system blocking mutex. So, when you took your operating system course as an undergrad, this is basically the thing that they teach you to start off with, right? And the reason is because they're simple to use, and they rely on the OS to do a lot of the hard work that we'll see later on that the database system has to do if you don't use this, right? The problem with the blocking mutex is that they're super, super slow and non-scalable. You should never actually try to use one of these mutexes, right? It's roughly about 25 nanoseconds per lock and unlock invocation, which is a lot. So in the case of how you actually implement this, so in C++11, they added in the standard template library, they added now this mutex keyword. Right, so now when C++11 came out, they basically started adding in multi-threading and other primitives that people have been using for years in all these different libraries, but now it's been sort of codified in the actual standard itself, which is kind of nice. But standard mutex, at least on Linux, is just a wrapper around pthread mutex. And the pthread library has been around for decades. And this is just a wrapper around the OS call futex. Does anybody know what a futex is? Stands for fast user space mutex. So what happens is with the futex is if no one holds it's basically a compare and swap flag at the high level. So if your thread comes along and just tries to do a compare and swap to grab the Boolean field to acquire the lock, if no one else holds it, you grab it right away and you're done. If there's contention on the lock, meaning somebody holds it, what happens is your thread will then make a futex call down into the operating system to add yourself to the queue of threads that are waiting to acquire this mutex, and then it notifies the scheduler to not schedule your thread anymore because you can't do anything because you're waiting for this thing, right? So this is why it's slow, because there's a bunch of syscalls now. If I try to acquire the mutex, I can't, and I have to go down to the OS and block myself. So anytime you make a syscall into the kernel, that's super slow. And then if you're the thread that does own the lock and you release it, that's another syscall to now go down back in the OS and say, all right, I released this mutex, go wake up and interrupt any of the threads that are blocked on this, and now start trying to schedule them to run. So that's why it's super slow, and you never want to do this. But for your own purpose of understanding this, the way you would do this is you just define the mutex here, and then you have the unlock and unlock commands, right? And underneath the covers, it translates that to the proper syscall to make this work. So we haven't done this yet, but at some point in Peloton, we're going to add, I'm going to add flags in the source code validator to throw an error if anybody tries to write a mutex. You should not be writing a mutex for your skip list. That's a terrible idea. Okay, so if people aren't writing mutexes in databases, what's a better thing? The better thing to use is what's called a test and set spin lock, or just a straight spin lock. And the idea here is that we're going to have that same sort of Boolean flag in memory that we can then do a compare and swap to try to acquire. And if we can get it, we're done. We have it. If we don't, then we'll just spin back around and try to acquire it over and over again. So it sort of looks like this, right? So we have the way you could define this is that in the C++11, they define the atomic keyword or atomic type that's templated, and you can put in whatever the type it is you're trying to acquire the lock on. In this case here, I'm using atomic flag, and this is just a specialization of doing atomic for a Boolean. And if you read the spec for C++11, they say that if you use atomic flag, then this is guaranteed to always be lock-free, where other data types might not always be the case. So we define our latch, and then we have a while loop that calls test and set. And this is essentially the same thing as compare and swap. And if we acquire it, we're done. If not, then we loop back around and try to acquire it over and over again. All right? This is called a spin lock. So you're just spinning back over, try to get over and over again. So the question is now, what do we actually put in here inside the while loop? Right? Remember before when we had the mutex, I said that if you can't acquire the lock, you get dropped down into the kernel and your thread gets blocked. Right? And the scheduler knows not to run you again. In this case here, the scheduler doesn't know you're trying to acquire a lock over and over again that you can't acquire, because it just sees you running instructions, burning cycles. So it thinks you're doing something, so it lets you keep getting quantums and keep on running, but when actuality, you're not doing anything. So now inside of our database system, we have to be careful about when we have these things, we have to define what we actually want to do. Right? We could yield our thread back to the OS and let some other thread try to run. Maybe that's the one that holds the latch we need, and then it can release it, and we can pick up and get going. We could try to retry over and over again to infinity, but that's usually a bad idea. So at some point, we need to maintain a counter and say, we've tried this amount of time, these number of times, we waited this long, and at some point we'll just abort because we can't acquire it. All right? So these are super efficient to implement because, again, it's a single instruction to do this test and set because it gets down to be a compare and swap at the CPU. But they're not scalable and they're not cache friendly. You want to take a guess why they're not cache friendly? So let's say I have a single latch. And I have three CPUs all trying to do test and set on it to acquire it over and over again. And let's say these threads are running on different sockets. So every single time I want to invoke test and set, I have to again do a lookup over whatever the bus is to the other socket to get to that location in memory and try to do the test and set. Or bring it to my local CPU and do the test and set there, depending on what's going on at the motherboard. So if I'm just spinning as fast as I can, I'm sending all this network traffic to go to this one latch location in memory and try to acquire it. Right? It's not like if I'm just doing a regular read. If I read a remote memory location, then the motherboard will put the value of that memory memory contents to my local CPU caches, and all my reads can be real fast because I'm reading the local thing. But because this is some global state that's being maintained at another socket, then I can't use my cache. I have to go over the bus to go get the contents and try to do the test and set. So we'll talk more about NUMA regions and how you actually store memory in different sockets and what the implications of that are. It mostly becomes a bigger deal when you start doing OLAP queries. We have to scan large chunks of memory. But in the case of a spin lock, this is a simple thing that shows up being a big problem. So the way to fix this is to use what's called queue-based spin locks. And these sometimes, if you Google this, sometimes they'll be called MCS spin locks. And this is actually named for two guys that invented it, Mello, Crummy, and Scott. And this, you get a spin lock in Linux. This is essentially what you're getting, one of these things here. So the benefit we're going to have of a queue-based spin lock is they're going to be more efficient than a mutex and have better less cache locality than a spin lock. So it looks sort of like this. So it's going to be, we're going to create a chain or a queue of these different spin locks and have the threads that are trying to acquire the lock, the higher level latch, they have to sort of, they'll spin on just one latch that's unique to them or close to them, rather than having it all spin at the global latch. So I have my base latch here, and it's essentially going to have a pointer to the next latch in my chain or my queue. And so there's no real type called latch. I'm just sort of saying here's a address to some memory location that'll have the next latch in our chain. So when the first CPU comes along, they'll do a compare and swap on this memory location here. And if nobody's holding it, then it's allowed to acquire it. And it's going to go replace the location now with a pointer to the next latch in the chain. All right? So now when the next CPU comes along, they try to do a compare and swap on the base latch. They're not going to get that because this guy holds it. And they're going to see, oh, well, it's not null. It's a pointer to some other latch. So let me try to do a compare and swap on that. So it's going to be waiting for this. Now the third thread comes along. It does the same thing. It tries to do a compare and swap on the base latch. Can't get that. Tries to do a compare and swap on this. Can't get that. So then it ends up waiting on this one here, and so forth and so forth. All right, so now what's happening is this guy's not spinning because he holds the lock. But this guy's spinning on this, and this will be local to him. And this guy's spinning on that, which is local to him. So this sounds awesome, right? Because now we're not worried about cache coherence traffic or network traffic on the low-level CPU. The tricky thing, though, is actually this is really complicated to implement because remember, since these are just spin locks, in my while loop, I could decide that I've waited too long and I want to abort. So now, if like this guy decides to abort, I need to make sure that the chain is still connected so that this guy knows that he's now the next one waiting, right? And that's not trivial to do. But now if you could have a really long chain, you could have two threads decide they didn't want to abort at the same time. You make sure that you don't have dangling pointers in that case. So performance-wise, these are better, but this is hard to implement and hard to get correct. And we don't support this in our database system. But as I said, I think Linux, in the Linux kernel, this is the type of spin lock they use. Okay? So as I go through these different latch implementations, I'm not saying one is better than the other. I mean, the Immutex one is total garbage. I can never use that, right? But there may be some cases where the spin lock is better than you want this, if you know you don't have a lot of cores. And then for the last type of latch, again, I'm not saying that this is better than the MCS. I'm saying this solves a different problem. So the last type of latch we can have are called reader-writer locks. And this is going to allow us to have concurrent readers because we can have multiple threads hold the same read lock at the same time. So the basic idea is that now for our latch, internally, it's going to have two sort of internal latches. And you have one for the reads and one for the writes. But they're also going to have two counters to keep track of the number of threads that currently hold the read lock and the number of threads that are currently hold the write lock, and then likewise, the number of threads that are waiting to acquire this. So when our first thread comes along, it wants to acquire the read lock. It's not being held, and the write lock's not being held, so go ahead and can acquire it, and we just update this counter by one. In this case here, you're doing an atomic add to make sure that you're doing this in a single instruction without having to take a mutex for updating the internals of this thing itself. Same thing, next thread comes along, wants to acquire the read lock. This is already being held by this guy, so we can allow it to also acquire it as well, and then we update the counter. Now someone wants to come along and wants to acquire the write lock, and here we again recognize that our counter is greater than zero, so therefore we're going to have to stall and wait. And then now the last thread comes along and it says, I want to acquire the read lock. What should happen here? Take a guess. Does it acquire the lock or no? Right, yeah, no, because it knows that this guy is waiting for to acquire it, so therefore it has to stall. And we update the counter and say, here's the number of threads that are stolen. And eventually these guys will finish off, and this guy can acquire the write lock. So again, the way you implement these is just using the same sort of primitive spin locks that I showed before. The tricky thing, though, is you've got to make sure that you don't starve out one side of the lock or another, right? And the example I showed here, it was a really simple heuristic to recognize, oh, well, I know that there's at least one write lock, so let me go ahead and acquire it, right? And you could do the same thing the other way. I'm holding the write lock, and there's another guy behind me, and when this guy releases, I can decide whether to allow the read guys go or the write guys go. And which way you do depends on how you're trying to use this latch, right? You may want to prefer to have readers go or writers go, and really, again, really depends on the application. It depends on what the data structure that you're trying to protect. Okay, these are also very common, but we don't implement these yet in our system. All right, so So any questions about like how you actually implement a latch? The spin lock is the easiest one to understand. The MCS one or the reader writer one is more complicated, but those are very common. So now that we know how to implement a latch, now we want to use them, right? And we want to use this now to we're going to use latches now to protect the internal structure of the of a B plus tree when we have multiple threads going through them and traversing them. So the method or protocol you would use to safely traverse a B plus tree. And for this purposes, since B plus tree is sort of always taught in intro class, I'll assume everyone already knows what a B plus tree is, and then we can talk about more the other type of data structures in next class. But for our purposes here, we can understand latch crabbing in the context of B plus trees without having to go through and describe what the actual data structure is over and over again. All right, so with latch crabbing, the basic idea is that we're going to acquire latches as we go down from one node to the next into the tree to get to the leaf nodes, because that's where the values are, it's where the data is, or the pointers we want. And as we go down, we'll be allowed to release the latch that we hold for the parent node if we're at a child node that we know is considered to be safe. And we would say safe would mean that we know that there's not going to be, that child node will not either have to be split or merged due to some change that occurs below it in the index. Right, so I'll describe the search and insert and delete, and then I'll show examples of this. So do a search, you're gonna start at the root, because that's where always the starting point is for the B plus tree, and you're gonna go down and you acquire read latches all the way down. And then if you know that, in this case here, you know that's always going to be safe because you're not modifying the index. So once you acquire the read latch from one node, you can release the latch you hold for its parent node. But to do an insert and delete, you have to take write latches all the way down. But once you acquire the write latch for the child, your sort of current location in the tree, if you know it's not going to be split or merge, then you can go ahead and release the write latch you hold on the parent. Again, a split would occur if the node is full, meaning we can't put any more keys in it, and you have to merge if it's less than half empty. Right? In practice, nobody actually, intro class, we always say that the merge algorithm always gets invoked when the node is less than half full, or half full and less. In practice, they actually relax that constraint a little bit and doesn't affect the correctness of the index. And they do that for performance reasons, because there's sort of less churn in the index. All right, so let's look at a simple example here. So we have our B plus tree, and I've labeled the nodes A, B, C, D to G. So the first thing we want to do is do a lookup on 23. So again, we always start at the root, and we're going to acquire the read latch on A, and then we traverse down to C, and once we acquire the read latch on this, we know it's safe to go ahead and release the latch on A, because we've reached this point. So we can go ahead and do that, and then get down to F, release the latch on C, and then we can go read the thing that we want. So this is sort of why it's called latch crabbing, because it's supposed to be how a crab walks. Like you're acquiring latches, one after another, right? It's a stretch, but whatever. So now let's talk about how you actually when you modify the index. So in this case here, we're going to do a delete on 44, which is down here in G. So we always have to start off at the root, taking a right latch. And then when we get down to C, we would recognize that since we're doing a delete, and this guy is half four or less, we don't know what's going to happen below us, so we may have to merge or coalesce this node here, it's not safe for us to release the latch on A. And again, visually you see this, that you know that you're not going to have this problem, but in actuality, when you're actually running through this data structure, when you're at this point of the tree, you don't know what's below you, so you have to be careful. So then when we finally get down to G, it's here we recognize that, all right, we can delete 44, and we're still going to be half full. So we know that we're not going to have to merge anything. So it's safe for us to release the write latches on C and A, and then we can go ahead and delete our record. Is that sort of clear how we're doing this, right? You're releasing them as you go down. So one more example, let's do insert on 44. Again, same thing at the top. We take a write latch. We get to C. And now here we recognize, since we're doing an insert, not a delete, that since this guy's not half full, we know that if there's a split below us, we can still accommodate one more key here. So at that point, we know it's safe to go ahead and release the latch on A. Right? Because A could never be affected by whatever happens below C. Because C always has free space. Then we get to G. Same thing here. Since we want to start at 40, and that would be between 38 and 40, and we already have two keys being used, we don't have a third one, so we're going to have to split G, so therefore we still have to hold the right lock on C. So we go ahead and create our new node, update our pointers, and then we can insert our new entry here, right? And we can update the inner node up in here to now point to, say you want 44 or more, you go over there. So here again, to do this insert with a split, I had to maintain the right latch on G and right latch on C. Why don't I have to acquire the right latch on H?
It didn't exist until you made it,
and no one could see it because I have an exclusive lock on C. So if anybody comes and tries to read this, they can't. So they're not going to be able to read my new node at this point. And at that point, I can release all my latches. So in crabbing, unlike in two-phase locking with multi-granular two-phase locking, where you have to release locks, I think, from bottom up, in the case of in latch crabbing, you don't have to do that. And you just want to release the latches as soon as possible. So the ordering in which you release the latches doesn't actually matter. So what I'm trying to say is, in this case here, it's okay for me to release the latch on G first, followed by C, or C first, followed by G. And that doesn't affect the correctness at all, right? Because I've made sure I installed all my pointers, so the structure of the index is still valid, still sound. Right? There's no pointer pointing to some memory location that goes to nothing, and we would get a seg fault. So in these two examples that I showed were for the insert and delete, what was the first operation, the first step that I always did? As I was doing latch crabbing, as I was going down, what's the very first thing I did?
Get a latch
on the root, right? So in the case, so this is bad because in this case, I'm acquiring a right latch on the root. So that means that anytime anybody wants to update the index, they got to go through basically this main bottleneck here, right? And this, people observed obviously in the early days of B plus trees that this was a bad idea, because now you're basically running it almost like in serial order to update index, which was meant to be concurrent. So there's a better latch crabbing algorithm that came out in the late 1970s, 1977. So again, the first sort of B plus tree came out in 72. So then this is an update to 77, how to do this latch crabbing better. So what we're going to do is we're going to optimistically assume that the leaf node that we're going to do an insert or delete on is going to be safe, meaning we're not going to have to split it, we're not going to have to merge it. So we're going to take read latches all the way down, doing the same crabbing thing. We release our parent since we acquire the child node. And then when we reach to the leaf node, we'll acquire the exclusive lock, and then we'll just verify that our assumption that it was not going to have to split or merge is correct. And if it is, then we just do what it is that we need to do, and we're done. If it's not, then we just go back and do the same algorithm that I showed before, where we acquire the right latch on the root as you go down. So it's pretty simple to understand. So let's just do one example. We'll do that delete on 44. So again, I'm going to take a read latch on A, read latch on C, and at this point, I can release the read latch on A. And then now I acquire the exclusive latch on G. And at this point, I know that to do this delete, I don't have to merge. So therefore, I can release the latch on C. So my assumption was valid, my assumption is correct. Right, so this is way better because you're allowing for better parallelism, better concurrency, because you're not bottlenecked on everyone trying to acquire the right lock on A. Right, this looks a lot like optimistic concurrency control. And actually, this idea that you're going to be optimistic about assuming how you acquire locks shows up a lot in other areas of computer science as well. This is essentially the same way that transactional memory works. Right, transactional memory allows you to do whatever you need to do your writes into memory, assuming there's not going to be any problems. And at the end, you just validate, make sure everything's okay. And if not, then you go back and take heavyweight locks to do the thing that failed the first time. Right? So we'll go fast, assuming everything's going to be okay. And if that fails, we come back and do the more heavyweight search. And this makes sense, right? Because most of the time, most of your inserts and deletes aren't going to require you to do splits and merges, right? In our case, for our BW tree, we support 128 keys per node, right? So you're not really going to be churning through new nodes all the time, or having to reorganize everything. All right. So crabbing is an analysis to ensure that we don't corrupt the internal data structure of our index during modifications. So that's good. That solved the problem that we wanted to solve by having multiple threads going into the same data structure at the same time. But remember, we said that in the case of latches, transactions or threads are going to release the latches that they hold as soon as they finish the operation that they wanted to do. So in the case of my do my delete, I took latches all the way down. I took the exclusive the write latch at the leaf node. As soon as I did my delete, I released it, right? But now the problem with this will guarantee that the data structure will be correct, but it's not going to guarantee that the logical contents will be correct, right? And in practice, we can incur phantoms. So let's look at one scenario here, right? Same tree that we had before. I'm going to have two transactions running. So the first transaction wants to do a conditional insert. It wants to see, do I have, if the key 25 doesn't exist, I want to go ahead and insert it. So it starts off by doing a check on 25. So the same thing, it does latch crabbing all the way down to get to this node here, and it sees, oh, 25 should be here, but it's not. So I now go ahead and insert it. But before it can come back and insert it, transaction 2 comes along, and he wants to insert 25, and he goes down, does crabbing, gets to the bottom, and inserts 25. Voila, he's done. And then now when transaction 1 comes back and tries to insert 25, he's going to come down, and he's going to try to insert this, but then he's going to hit a collision because the other transaction came along and inserted before he could. Right? Because between the first check and then the insert, we didn't hold the latch for this, because that's not how the protocol works. Okay? Now you could imagine, yes, you could provide conditional insert where I'll do the search, and if it doesn't exist, only insert it then. But there's other scenarios where you could hit the same problem. Let's look at another one. So this one here, the transaction 1 wants to scan the range 22 to 23. So this is, again, in an intro class, this is not something that people actually, we don't teach or talk about, but this is actually very common, because usually, sometimes you can do scans along the leaf nodes to find the data you're looking for, rather than doing scans of the tuples in the heap. So we're going to do latch crabbing to get down to node E here, and we would start scanning at 12, and recognize that we need to go look over here, in this node over here, so we need to acquire the read latch for this in order to complete our scan. Now, in this example, I just jumped across the sibling pointer and acquired the read latch. In practice, you can't do that because someone could be coming the other way and you'd have deadlock. And this your pointer to this location may have changed because something might have occurred over here to cause this node to get deleted and replaced with something else. But for simplicity, I'm just saying that, yes, you can go across here, but in practice, you can't. At least not easily. So at here, again, we completed our scan. So we saw all the values from 12 to 23. In this case, it's only 12 and 23. Transaction 2 comes along, wants to insert 21, takes read latches all the way down, and then it can insert its new value here. And then the same thing, we come back now, the same transaction does the same scan, and it would now see that 21 was here. Now, it's an unrepeatable read. It's seeing something that, it's a phantom read. It's seeing something that did not exist in the range when it scanned the first time. So latch crabbing doesn't help us here, right? We need something else, right? And this is what index locks are going to do for us. So index locks are going to allow us to protect the logical contents of the index and to avoid phantoms or interference with other transactions running at the same time. So we'll be doing this concurrently with the latch crabbing or taking latches in the data structure, right? This is sort of a high-level construct to make sure the logical contents are correct. But when we go inside the index, we still have to take all of our latches. So this is not meant to replace latches. This is used in conjunction with latches. So again, the key difference we talked about at the beginning between locks, index locks and latches, is that these index locks are going to be held for the entire duration of the transaction. And we're only going to acquire them at the leaf nodes of the index in our B plus tree. Remember, in the latches, we can acquire them all up and down the tree. But for these locks, we only acquire them at the bottom. And the reason why we do this is because they're not... The keys in the upper levels of the tree may not actually be to real values, right? You could delete a key from the index and it would get deleted from the leaf node, but it may still be used as a guidepost or a search marker in the upper levels of the tree. The last key distinction is that the index locks that we'll talk about are not physically stored inside the data structure itself. So the latches that I was showing you here, when we're doing latch crabbing, those are usually stored inside in memory inside the node for each leaf node, right? With these index locks, they can't be stored inside of the index because the physical organization in memory of the index may change. So think about this. So if I'm going to take an index lock, say a simple index lock is I want to take a lock on key 5. If now I acquire that lock and some other transaction inserts a bunch of stuff, key 5 is still valid, but now the data structure has changed because we've done splits and merges. If I'm inside my transaction context handle, if I'm pointing to that lock to know that I have it, it may have gotten moved because the index of the B plus tree got reorganized. So now if you say, all right, well, I don't want to store pointers to my locks that I hold in my transaction context handle. I'll just only store them inside the data structure. But now when a transaction commits, you don't know what locks you have, and therefore you need to validate and release. You'd have to scan the leaf node of every single index to find the locks that you hold. Is this clear? So this sort of goes against what I said before about how in an in-memory system, we can maintain the locks that we have to hold on tuples themselves directly in the header of the tuple. Right? Now when I'm saying inside an in-memory index, you can't hold these locks inside the data structure. They have to be stored in an auxiliary space. Because the physical contents, the physical organization of the index can change, whereas the tuples don't change. And so the lock table sort of looks like this. It's pretty basic. Usually there's some kind of, it's usually like a latch tree hash table, and you have some way to map the logical key to some location in the hash table, and it'll point to a queue of transactions that are either hold or waiting to acquire the lock. So typically what happens is always the first element in the queue is the one that's holding the lock, and everything that comes behind it is waiting to acquire it. So this guy here, this is a transaction one holds an exclusive lock, whatever this lock is, and all these other guys are waiting. For this one here, since the shared lock is compatible with other shared locks, all these three transactions also all hold the same lock at the same time, right? And there may be other transactions behind this trying to acquire, you know, an exclusive lock. So the nice thing about this is, though, you can actually implement this. There are lock-free hash tables, and you can have latch-free hash tables and latch-free queues. So it's not like you have to acquire a latch to go into this, depending on how it's actually implemented, every single time. But again, this is not free, right? Because it's a lookup to go find the thing you're looking for. Then you have to traverse the queue and check to see whether you're the only one here or whether you need to block and add yourself to the back of the queue. All right, so I'm going to talk about 5 different types of locks, and these are all sort of described in the paper you guys read. So we'll start off with predicate locks, and these are sort of like a thought experiment, a nice thing, but nobody actually implements them. And then we'll have the real ones that will build up to the final one, the hierarchical locking, which is what everyone actually implements in their indexes, if you're doing latch crabbing and locking inside of an index. So predicate locks were the first sort of locking scheme for transactions and indexes that came out of the System R group at IBM. Again, what I really love about the System R project is just sort of the way it sort of it came about. Like, they took 8 people that were super smart and had PhDs. They put them in a room and said, make me a relational database. And they all sort of broke off, and every person, you know, one of those 8 people worked on, you know, some different part of the system. They sort of all combined it together. Like, one woman worked on the cost-based query optimization. Somebody else worked on the SQL language. And Jim Gray and his people worked on coming up with locking scheme and concurrency control and, you know, the early days of all this. So in the one of the original papers from System R from 1976, they describe the predicate locking scheme. But as I said, this is actually difficult to implement in practice, so nobody actually does this. There is something called precision locks that Hyper uses that comes pretty close, but as I'll describe here in the original paper, no one does this. So the basic idea is that you'll take shared locks on predicates that are in the where clauses for select statements, and then you'll take exclusive locks on predicates for the update and delete queries. In the case of an insert query, there's no where clause. You just take a conjunction of the values you're trying to insert, and that's equivalent to doing a where clause. So it's kind of better maybe to visualize this and see what it looks like. So say I have 2 queries here. Right, this is computing a sum aggregate on the balance for the accounts, where the name of the account holder is Biggie. And then we have another query that wants to insert into accounts to add a new record for Biggie with an amount of 100. So down here, see, think of this sort of as a 2D projection of the key space for this table account. And so for the first query here, we would look at the where clause and see name equals busy, Biggie. And then this space here represents all the keys that exist in the accounts table with the count name equals Biggie. So now when I look at the insert statement, again, there's no where clause, so I take a conjunction on name equals Biggie and balance equals 100, and I see that this space overlaps with the larger key space where name equals Biggie, right? Because we're qualifying this to say, here's all the keys or the elements of the table where balance equals 100 and name equals busy, and that has to be a subset of all possible keys where name equals Biggie. And so if you see that you have an overlap, you would know that these two predicates conflict, and therefore you have to be mindful of that. Like, if this guy comes first, you can't acquire this other guy can't acquire the lock on this space because he overlaps with this other one here, right? So intuitively, this is kind of easy to understand, but in practice, this is really hard to implement. Part of the reason is now because I'm showing a table with two elements or two attributes. You can have a ton of different attributes, and now your space is not 2D, it's multidimensional. And you have to see whether you have these different spaces intersect. The other issue also, too, is that the output of, if you have a nested query, and the output of one inner query could be used as the input for the outer query, then it's hard to derive what these predicate locks should look like in that case there. Right? In this example here, what's nice is that I can actually derive what the locks are without actually running the queries, because I'm just looking at the logical semantics of the where clause or the predicate. In all the other schemes that we'll talk about next, you only know whether you would only know what elements the query is looking at until you actually execute the query. So you can do this prior to the query and prior execution. All the other ones have to be done as execution. Like as I said, nobody actually implements this, but it's sort of a nice thing to understand. All right, so now we're going to talk about how to actually build up now the type of locks we can take in our indexes to see how we actually handle phantoms in harder cases. So the most simple type of index lock you'd have are key value locks, and this is exactly what you would think it would be for a single value in single key inside of the in a leaf tree a leaf node. We can acquire the lock for it, right? So in this case here, we have the transaction acquired the lock for from 14 to 14 exclusive. So this some transaction holds the lock to this thing here, and nobody else can delete it. So the tricky thing though is that we need to handle the case where there could be non-existent keys. And so this is part of the reason why another reason why you have to store everything in a separate locking table is like there's no element 15 here, so I can't store a lock for it because it doesn't exist. Right? Say this is 14 to 1 billion. I don't want to pre-allocate a billion slots for keys because someone might acquire locks for those elements if they're never going to happen. Right? So you store it outside of it, and it has a more compact representation, more compact. You have to store less data to store the non-existent keys. So the way you handle non-existent keys is through gap locks. So it's essentially the same thing as a key value lock, except you're locking the space where there are no keys, right? So in between 10 to 12, there's a gap, 12 to 14, there's a gap, and so forth. So I can have a transaction acquire the gap lock from the space from 14 to 16 exclusive. So now if someone tries to insert 15 here and another thread holds the gap lock, they can't do that because they'd have to acquire the gap lock first in order to do that. Now we can combine the key value locks and the gap locks to come up with key range locks. And this is, again, this allows us to have a wider range of key space that we can acquire inside the leaf node here. So the basic idea is that we say we jump to some location in the key space and we can acquire the lock for that key value as well as the gap lock next to it. So in this case here, a next key value lock or key range lock would be from 14 inclusive into the gap, but not over to 16. We can go the other direction and do prior key locks. In this case here, it'd be from the gap after 12 up until 14 inclusive. So you can take next key or prior key. There's no real difference of the two. But the key thing is that you can only go in one direction. So you can only have next key locks, and you can't mix them together with the prior key locks, because that causes problems. And in practice, most systems actually implement the next key locks, right? And this is sort of a byproduct of us, you know, if you maybe reading English or just understanding how the index works, right? Most of the time you're scanning in this direction, so it makes more sense to sort of start here and take the gap next to you. But again, like, I don't think from a scientific standpoint, I don't think there's any major difference. This is just the way everyone does it. All right, so now we have key value locks, we have gap locks, we combine them together into key range locks. And then the last piece that we need is to do hierarchical locking. So what I showed before was we were acquiring locks on just sort of one key value and the gap next to it. But if we now need to acquire locks for multiple gaps and multiple key values, then we have to acquire multiple locks. Right? And every single time you have to acquire a new lock, you have to go to the lock manager, traverse the queue, and figure out whether you can acquire the lock or not, and then add yourself. So with hierarchical locking, this is the same idea that we had in multigranular locking in two-phase locking that we discussed in the intro course, is that we can acquire a higher level lock for some multiple elements or multiple key value gaps, and then we can take more refined, more exclusive locks inside of the range when we go down. So let's say that we have a transaction and wants to acquire an intention exclusive lock for this entire range. I want to acquire that, then I can take the exclusive lock for just this key in this gap here. So, everyone remind me what the intention exclusive means from last semester. What does that mean?
Someone acquires an exclusive lock on the lower level.
Correct. So he said that there's intention exclusive means that at a higher level, we're acquiring a lock that says, hey, someone at the lower level is acquiring an exclusive lock. Just be mindful of that. And so the intention exclusive lock is not compatible with the shared lock, so no one can come down and try to read all this while we hold this. And that can help us prevent phantoms, because someone may try to insert something in the range we're trying to insert on. But intention exclusive is compatible with the intention exclusive. So another transaction can come along, and they can modify, take a key value exclusive lock on one of these elements, and that's okay, because we're not tripping up over here. Right, because then if this guy tried to also insert maybe 15, he wouldn't be able to do that. Even though he has the intention exclusive lock up above, he can't acquire the exclusive lock on 15 here. So by having a hierarchical locking allows us to have better concurrency, because we can better concurrency while also taking fewer locks or fewer round trips into the lock manager. Right, and the same argument that you make in multigranular locking with two-phase locking at a concurrential level, That all applies here inside of our indexes. So, given I just spent a half an hour discussing locking schemes inside of the index, what I'll say is that the more modern in-memory systems don't actually do what I just described. And part of the reason is that they want to have these, they want to avoid having to take heavy locks inside of indexes. So we saw this in Silo. Right, Silo basically does revalidation on the scan set of nodes inside the index to check to see whether it's been modified since the last time you ran the query. In Hecaton, they actually do take locks, but on the hash table that's organizing the buckets of tuples, but they don't actually take the index locks at the and sort of in the internals of the BW tree that I'm showing here. So hierarchical locking is nice, and it's essential because it provides us essentially with predicate locking without having to figure out what predicates overlap with other predicates, because we know exactly what the predicate's trying to do, because in order to grab the tuple or grab the keys that they need for the scan operation or insert or update or delete, we can acquire the locks on the low level elements or the keys inside of our index. And then reminder then, we only take the locks at the leaf nodes in the tree, but in the everywhere else, we have to take latches to ensure that we have a consistent data structure. So now, currently in our system, we don't actually support serializable isolation. We have range scans. So you can do range scans on our BW tree, and this will be required for you to do in your skip list. But there's not going to be a higher level mechanism in the concurrential protocol to actually do either index locking or revalidation to make sure that there are no phantoms. This is something we simply just don't support at this point. But there's standard techniques that we can make this work. So any questions about index latching or index locking? Okay, so next class, I think I get real excited about, because now we start talking about different types of indexes, right? So again, we spent today talking about the B plus tree, and that's, again, we take an intro course. This is usually what we ever teach you, but there's way other trees you could use in database systems that no one ever teaches. So we're gonna cover a lot of these different things. So we'll talk about T-trees that came out of the 1980s and was used in Oracle Times 10 in the 1990s, but no one actually implements this now. And then we'll spend some time talking about how to do concurrent skip lists. And this is, again, this is what Project 2 is all about. And as far as I know, the only database system that uses this as the primary index would be MemSQL. So the assigned reading for you guys for next Tuesday is a blog post by some guy who, actually, I don't know what his real name is, because it's not published anywhere. But he basically has a nice description of how you actually make a skip list high performant. So the original skip list, as we'll see on Tuesday, is actually really slow on a multi-core architecture because it's not very cache friendly. So the assigned reading will show you how you actually make it good. And it's using a lot of the same techniques that the MemSQL guys did. We'll also spend time at the beginning to... Awesome. We're almost done anyway. We'll spend time in the beginning talking about how do you represent the keys inside of the index, right? Usually, again, when the example I showed here, I'm dealing with single integers. But if you have to have multiple integers or mixed with integers and strings, how do you actually do that? And how can you actually do lookups and comparisons of these things to make it really, really fast? And then we'll talk about how you do memory allocation and garbage collection inside of an index as well, if you have a latch tree index. Again, this is something you're also going to have to implement in project number two. In the case of index key representation, as you see in the project specification, we do all this for you. So you're just given a key type and you just store it as a blob, and you're given a class that allows you to do comparisons. So all that sort of taken care of for you, but I'll show you how you can actually make it work really fast. Any questions? All right, awesome guys, thanks.